Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been saved. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life is. Chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace.
We are here today to honor the life of Paul Stanley Shelor. Paul was born December 19, 1952, to Maxie and Theo Henderson Shelor in Muskogee, Oklahoma, and passed from this life on Tuesday, September 12, 2017, and he was 64 years old. Paul graduated from Muskogee High School with the class of 1971. Anyone who has lived in Muskogee area very long knows Paul Shelor. He knew everyone. Sometimes I thought he was making people up when he was asking me if I knew someone. He never met a stranger. He was one of those people who just had a way of making you feel important, making you feel like you had his undivided attention. But I got to thinking about it yesterday and figured out why that was, and it was because you were important to him. He loved people. He was one of the most giving people I knew. From helping his family to meeting with his flock of ladies. He had some of the guys called him his harem here at the church. But as you can imagine, he catered to their every need and loved every minute of it. Paul loved meeting people's needs, both by giving monetarily, but also with a big hug and a big smile. When he worked at Gaddy's Drug making deliveries, he developed a lot of friendships. The customers loved him. More than once, he told me he thought he was going to lose his job because he took too long at each house. You know, he didn't just deliver, he had to stop and do some ministry, too. That's what he called it. The customers loved him, but not more than he did them. Often he was known many times to help foot the bill of people that didn't quite have enough to pay for their medication. And he'd tell me, "Pastor, I just can't let those little old folks go without their medicine." I said, "Paul, I understand, but you're older than them." But anyway, he didn't think that was all that funny, but I thought it was funny. Jason said that Paul reminded him of Will Rogers, that he never met a man he didn't like. He had the unique ability to find the good in everyone, and Paul was a land surveyor for the Oklahoma Department of Transportation until his retirement, and I've had the pleasure of hearing Paul and a few others share some stories from their time with ODOT, and I can tell you now, from reptile stories to bathroom stories, miscellaneous pranks, Paul loved his time and his crew from ODOT. Paul was a member here at Timothy Baptist Church. He became a part of our church in June of 07, and Paul wasn't a hit-and-miss kind of church member. He was a permanent fixture. In fact, most every service, Paul sat right over there on the back row of that section right there. And you could see him above everyone when we were standing. You could pretty much see him above everyone when we were sitting. The people of Timothy didn't look at Paul as a friend. They looked at him as family. He was my friend and my brother and a loyal supporter of the ministry of this church and of me for over 10 years. Paul was on our lockup team. He locked up the building. I know, what were we thinking to let Paul lock up the building? To be honest with you, he loved it. And he was one that I never had to wonder if he was going to show up on his time. He loved it because he got to sit around, stay late, and visit with every single person till the last one was ready to go home. And he did it. He was also a member of our men's night that met every Tuesday night for Bible study, and those guys called him Animal. They knew him. Most of them knew his past as well as his present. And they didn't judge him, and he didn't judge them. We all just kind of know that the only good in us is because God gave it to us anyway. Many a man in this church has been comforted and encouraged by Paul over the last many years. And he loved coming to men's night and always offered to bring brownies if we were having potluck. Paul loved his family very much. He loved spending time and as much time as possible with you all. His love for you showed in the things he did, but I want you to know that it also showed when he spoke of you. He had a gleam in his eye. You know, to me, you were Jennifer, Jason, and Ashley, but to him, you were Jen, Jason, Ash. I began to call you all that in the last few weeks. He loved you. Loved the grandkids. He told story after story of you guys. And then when we met the other day and the kids began to tell me stories of the adventures of growing up a child of Paul Shelor. And my stomach was a little sore the next day. Definitely all agreed he was adventurous. I believe a few of you got some of that too. From motorcycle rides and roller coasters and OG&E and lightning storms, the kids all agreed that it was never boring growing up with Paul. But they defined him as a steady person in their life who was a good listener, who cared and showed it. I think Paul loved people so freely because he has such a soft heart. Linda pointed out that Paul was sensitive to others, people's needs, and a very sensitive person, and she's exactly right. He would call or text me often, asking what he could do to help someone at the church that he knew was going through a difficult time. Paul was preceded in death by his parents. He has survived and leaves a sweet family. His sister, Lisa Smith, and husband Bob, and his children, Jason, Jennifer, and her husband Jared, and Ashley, and her husband Alan. His grandchildren, who he cherished, Keely, Logan, Kennedy, Clay, Kaysen, Addison, and Kaylin. His significant other, Linda, and nieces and nephews, Alicia, Denise, and Jeff, and many other family members and friends. Paul was one of those people that didn't like for anyone to have a bad day. He enjoyed a good time. He could have a solemn look, and you walk up and start to tell something funny, and his whole demeanor changed, and he was in, full in. You know, he wasn't just kind of there. He was in, smile and all. So I want you to know, I know today that many of you showed up here with a grieving spirit. I understand that. You must know that it's one of the harder ones I'm going to ever do for a lot of reasons. But I want you to know you have something to celebrate too. Amen. We'll talk a little more about that later. Man, grieve if you may. But know that Paul Shelor's experiencing something much better than he ever experienced on earth today. Let's pray. Father, we thank you and we praise you for who you are, and we thank you for your grace, mercy, and love. And Lord, we just come to you now just asking you to be with this congregation and this family as we celebrate Paul's life, as we remember him, Father. I just ask you now, God, to allow all that we do here to bring glory and honor to you first, and then to honor such a wonderful guy as Paul was, Father. And Lord Jesus, we just give you the glory, honor, and praise for the life that he lived, and for the way he touched all of us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Soul will rest in your embrace, for I
Paul's son, Jason, is now going to come and speak on behalf of the family.
Don't you think Kelly kind of looks like Jim Tressel today? I was kind of giving a little bit of a... He looks great. I'm just saying he kind of has the Ohio State thing going. I'm Jason Shelor. I'm Paul Shelor's son. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about some things that we can try to remember about my father. He reminds me a lot of Will Rogers in Muskogee, because really he knew everybody. I could be somewhere, it's like, Paul Shelor's son. Sometimes, a long time ago, I'd be like, well, yes, I am. But, no, all kidding aside, he was such a great man. And my sisters and I were pretty fortunate and blessed. I think with Jennifer, I mean, I was talking to them like, hey, what would you want me to say? She's like, you know, she loved the skiing. She loved the floating. Music has always been a big part of our lives. Like, my dad and I would get in the biggest arguments over Pearl Jam because he said to this day he still could not understand what Eddie Vedder was saying. So I was like, Dad, they are one of the best bands alive, and I'm sorry you can't see that. You know, we would kind of get into it a little, not really get into it, but he knew, like, every musician. And we would just sit there and talk music all the time. I was also fortunate enough to have, you know, my uncles, they're here as well. You know, we all had kind of a musical background, and they really encouraged me to have that and to showcase that. And, you know, I'm very fortunate. And so I feel like I got a lot of that from him. You know, he would also encourage me, and I can't say enough how influential he was on my life, and definitely on my sister's. Ashley was, like I said, we talked about Kane's Ballroom. I think I have been to the Kane's Ballroom more times than anybody out there. If you've been to Kane's Ballroom more than me, then come see me after this, because I can guarantee you it's going to be pretty close. I was there when it didn't have air conditioning, when you would sweat to watch a good show. Sometimes you would leave and you're just like, oh my goodness, how am I gonna get out of here? Because by the time you're just drenched after watching some amazing show of a band that you've never even heard of, and then they become really big and everything. I think Ashley was also talking about how Dad was teaching her how to drive, because I'm actually at that point right now trying to teach my own daughter how to drive. And if anybody has a daughter who's 15 years old, then you know that that is a lot of prayer. But I'm thankful. I'm very blessed. I've had I'm 43. I've had a great life so far. I have the people that just played the two songs. I actually get to play with them most of the time every Sunday at the Brick. They are amazing musicians. So I'm very, very fortunate and blessed for you guys. Sorry. But I think the thing is that we're here to celebrate my dad's life. And, you know, I got some stories that maybe might help you, some good ones. One story that stands out, and I kind of told this story. I don't know if Ron Morton is in the audience tonight, but if he was, Ron Morton used to work for Channel 8, and I was a senior in high school. We had 3 days left before I was about to graduate, and Ron was doing a special on the Illinois River because it was high, and it was really, really high. So we decided to do our senior skip day, and as they're filming the water, we are going down the raft in a raft with beverages and making obscenities and showcasing the beer that we were drinking. And so the following day, because that was on a Thursday, and I'll never forget, because the following day I got called back into the office, and they said, "Mr. Shelor, were you drinking beer on the Illinois River?" And I'm like, "No, not at all." So what had happened was they got the tape from my dad, because my dad records everything. So, I mean, he recorded every episode of The Simpsons or whatever it is. He had them just, and I'm sitting there watching this video, and I am just making obscenities and, you know, holding the beer up. It was quite comical, but, you know, he gave me an option of having swats or being suspended, and I was like, okay, just give me swats. So I took them and went on my day. But, I mean, just little things like that. And I asked Dad, he's like, "Well, son, they asked for the tape because they knew I would record." I mean, he just recorded everything. And shit, if you just knew him, I'm like, why would you turn that in? You know, that's some things you just don't. But, you know, and his love for golf, too. I think everybody knows that he loved to play golf. My stepdad and my uncle, we were just about to go play some golf here very soon. And, you know, the last time I played with my dad, I was 2 strokes from beating him. I mean, you have no idea. For being his son, I was excited. I was so ready to beat him, and he came back and he beat me by 2 strokes. I wasn't super happy about it, so I was hoping I was gonna get that chance, but it didn't happen, and that's okay. I mean, I enjoyed the times playing golf and that I got to with him, and just a couple other things that my dad, you know, he loved his grandkids. He really did. Casey was telling me a story earlier today that he said that dad brought him back a motorcycle shirt, and they were throwing peace signs up, and he thought that was the coolest thing. I mean, he really did. He thought that was awesome. So, you know, I mean, he loved all his kids, and I mean, especially all his grandkids. And so many people in here, he loved each and every one of you. Like I said, I've had a great life. I've had everything, and I had 43 years with the man. And I'm very thankful, and I'm very blessed. And I have a lot of great friends that I got out of it, people that I've known, you know, pretty much all my life, even people from Bragg's. Just totally kidding, guys. I see some people, good, really good friends that I have that live in Bragg's. People that I've known all my life, you guys have been amazing. People, parents, Johnny and Debbie Shelor, definitely were like aunts and uncles to me. So, and especially our, you know, my sisters as well. I think I'm trying not to forget anything. Like I said, we were really, really fortunate and really blessed to have everything that, you know, we got to do some really silly things. And one last thing that I remember, the other night we were kind of picking up some things at Dad's, and my dad was really good about getting people cards, okay? And I found Keely's birthday card there and haven't given it to her yet. My birthday card was there, but when I graduated grad school, he said, "I forgot your card, I forgot your card." And I'm like, "That's okay, no big deal." I mean, I was just glad. He took like 400 pictures up there, because I remember when I was sitting in there and they were doing the commencement, he was just over there turning the camera sideways and all this and just taking the pictures. And by the time I get up there, he said, "I've got awesome shots for you to look at, yada, yada, yada." And I remember that conversation very well. But the other day when we went over there, I think it was Jennifer found it, and she said, "Hey, this has got your name on it." So I opened it up, and it was, I was on my way to my daughter's volleyball game, and it was just saying, "You're the first to have the master, you're first to get a master's, this is a feat, they cannot take your piece of paper away. You know, you've worked hard for this. you know, congratulations, and put a really awesome Bible verse in there. I wish I could just say it to you right offhand. I mean, I don't have that photographic memory, sorry, but I was very fortunate, and I mean, I'll be the first to tell you, I bawled like a baby all the way to her game. I show up, people probably don't even know, my eyes are probably swollen, but because I probably cried a lot that day, and you know, like I said, it was very moving, and to realize they still had that. And when I read it, it was just something amazing to me. But I mean, on behalf of my sisters and I, thanks for everybody that came out. We love. We love each and every one of you, and we are truly thankful and humbled that you guys came out. Thank you.
I hear the sound of a mighty rushing wind, and it's closer now than it's ever been. I can almost hear the trumpet as Gabriel sounds the call, sounds the call at the midnight cry. We'll be going. I look around me, I see prophecies fulfilled, signs of the times they're appearing everywhere. I can almost see the Father as it sits on, go get my children at the midnight cry. The bride of Christ will rise when Jesus steps out. Almost every day. and signs of the times, they're appearing everywhere. I can almost see the Father as he said, "Son, go get my children," and at the midnight cry, the bride of Christ will rise when Jesus steps out on a cloud and call God's children. The dead in Christ shall
from the lips of my brother. Pastor, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Why do people sit there like knots on logs at funerals when something cool happens? I don't know, so I'm going to go ahead and tell you. Praise the Lord, that was awesome. Thank you. I'm glad I got somewhere to go. You know, Paul looked at things like a lot of us do. Paul just had the nerve to ask. Paul had the nerve to say, "That's dumb. Why do we do that? I don't know. Don't do it." I want to start off by telling you there's not very many people in this world that I have more respect for than I do Paul Shelor. I've already said it. He's my friend and he's my brother. We've laughed together more times than I could even begin to count. We've cried together more times than I want to remember, too. We've done some crazy things together a few times, all by his prompting, mostly. But we've also got to serve God together. And through it all, the reason I say that I respect Paul so much is because he was always the same.
Amen.
Paul didn't put on different clothes depending on who was going to show up. We all know that too, don't we? He didn't change who he was because the president might show up. He was who he was. He was genuine. He was kind. And he'd look out for everybody else before himself. And if you were an underdog in any manner, he had your back. He tells me a lot. I still am not used. I may use present tense. As far as I'm concerned, he's not gone. But he tells me a lot. I just love you. You don't act like a preacher. And I was always like, I don't know. I can't decide if that's a good thing or a bad thing, bro. But knowing Paul, I went ahead and took it as good. I've titled the message this morning. I don't title funeral sermons. I usually title my Sunday morning, Sunday night, sometimes Wednesday night sermons. But I felt like I should title this sermon, so I'm going to tell you it's going to be a little different. Why not? Paul was, he would want it different. Amen. And the title's What Can We Learn from Paul? And I'm going to give you three things. And I'm going to talk a little bit under each one so y'all don't think you're fixing to get out of here. Number one, Paul loved everyone. Proverbs 18:24. Have you ever wondered why Paul had so many friends? Well, let me tell you. A man that hath friends must first show himself friendly. There you go. Paul was like the pup that ran up to you. You know, you couldn't help but like him. You just couldn't help but like him. One of the greatest traits a person can have is love. Matthew 22, Jesus is speaking. And some people begin to ask him some questions. And one says, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" And Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. That's the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself." Paul had those two down. He knew what it meant to love other people. I can't tell you the times that at the back door of the church, he's handed me $5, $10, $20 and said, "Hey, give this to so-and-so. I don't really want him to know I wanted him to have it, but give this to so-and-so." He just was one that liked to give to people. He liked to meet people's needs. Paul was a people watcher. He would watch people. He would come to me sometimes and say, "So-and-so okay?" "As far as I know, why?" "They act funny." He was watching. People in Paul's life knew that he was there for them and that he cared for them. He was never one to judge people. He was one to love people. He didn't always agree with what you did. He just usually didn't tell you. He just usually told God. Now, for those of you that think I only knew Paul as a Christian, I was his loan officer in the 80s. Okay? Yeah. And the 90s. I was three. It was such a blessing these past several weeks. As Paul's health began to, Paul's health didn't dwindle, it kind of crashed. Let's just be honest. It was a blessing to watch the kids and Linda. Y'all were awesome, all of you. You stood by him, not even knowing if he knew you were. But I think a few times we got a little glimpse that he knew it. I, as his friend, want to say thank you guys for stepping up to the plate. One day I was outside mowing my lawn at home. Paul drove by, which I just have to say, the dude was a stalker. He was constantly in his car driving around. Does anyone else know that? And it may not have been in day hours either. You tell me, "Yeah, I went by your house about 3 a.m. this morning and everything looked good." Thanks, bro. One day I was outside mowing and he drove by. And he yelled something that I only got the last word, and it was sexy. I was kind of glad I didn't get the rest of it, just to be honest with you. I threw my arm up and waved, and about 10 minutes later, he comes and he pulls over. I go over, And he hands me a Mountain Dew and a candy bar. He said, "You just look like you needed this." That was my Paul.
That's right.
You know, as I got to know him better, I knew that he just liked to talk. That's why he did it. He really wasn't giving. He just wanted to talk to you and it gave him I'm just kidding. But he did enjoy talking. I gladly had it and visited with him, and he stepped out of his way to step into your day all the time. That was just the way he was. Now, don't get me wrong. He would be mad at me, and I will see him again. So I'm going to make sure and cover this the right way. But I'm going to go ahead and tell you, Paul was stubborn and hard-headed. And he'd be mad at me if I painted him as this flower that didn't have some wilting. If he thought he was right, sometimes he let his pride overrule his heart. But give him a little time, and here he'd come back to make it right and to settle the score. What can we learn from him? Love people. Love people. Don't allow pride and stubbornness to bring division between you and the people you love. Love your family, love your friends, make a difference in their lives by doing the little things that make a difference. Don't wait till you can do something big every day, do something little. That's what Paul would say, and that's what we can learn from him. Whether it be a visit, a little gift, a text, a call, a silly gesture. Sorry, but it came to mind right quick. Or a hug. Paul loved people, and he did not mind showing it. Paul was kind. Second thing. Matthew 7:12. Do to others whatever you would like them to do to you. Paul treated people the way he wanted to be treated. He had so many acts of kindness that were behind the scenes that most people would never have known of. I told this. I put it on Facebook when it happened. And I talked about it from the pulpit, I think, last Wednesday night, a couple of days ago. I don't remember when. But August the 15th, our church went out to all the schools in Muskogee, Fort Gibson, and Hilldale District and walked around and praying for them, for the teachers and the students to have a good year. That's like a month ago. And that day, Paul shot me a text. I was glad he texted me and I didn't text him, because it would have said, "I'm in my Altima, I can't talk to you right now." Take that off of your phone. But anyway. He said, "Man, I'm sorry. I just can't do it. Not getting a good enough breath to come out and do the prayer walking." Sorry. I said, "Paul, it's fine. You can pray right where you are. Pray where you are." Me and Mike Haley, and I don't remember if anybody else was there with us or not, we're at ECC, walking around there praying. Everybody went to different places. And I got a text. I felt my phone vibrate, and I got it out, and it's Paul. It says, "Where are you?" I said, "Bro, I'm at ECC, taking my last round, and then I'm heading to Sadler." He said, "Okay, is it all right if I just pull up in front of the school and pray in my car?" Sure. Put my phone in my pocket. It vibrates about 5 minutes later, and it's Paul. He says, "Where's Sadler?" So that's Paul, though. You know, I mean, he's like, he was already driving before he thought to find out where he's headed. You know, it's just. So I told him, and in the slideshow that you're going to watch in a moment, you'll just see a picture that to you may seem odd, but to us it doesn't seem odd at all. Because I took it when I'm up walking around Sadler of him out in his car out by the road praying. And when we finished prayer walking and I was walking to my truck, which was behind his car, and I walked up to his window, Paul wasn't just sitting there. Paul's head was bowed and he could hear his words as he was praying for students and teachers to have a good and safe year. That was Paul. Paul was kind. I saw him at Come and Go, I would say in 2017, but you know, I'm old, so it could have been 3 years ago for that matter, but I think it was this year. This one right up here. And he is standing, kind of talking to a man and kind of not. And the guy's, just something looked odd to me, so I stopped and said, "Dude, what you doing, man?" And he said, "Oh, I'm just paying for this little man here to get a little bit of gas." I said, "Oh, who is it? Introduce me." He goes, "I don't know. I just met him in the store." He's helping him. That's Paul. Not only was he a nice person, he treated people better than he got treated a lot of times. He didn't keep score. He had old school politeness and manners, and he lived them out. He didn't like it when other people didn't. He didn't hold a grudge, well, not very often. And when others might have an issue with someone, I've heard him 100 times speak up in their defense with maybe a reason why they were acting the way they were. And I want to tell you why I believe Paul saw the best in folks. Sounds really elementary, but our society could learn from him because he looked for it. He didn't walk around trying to find something he didn't like. He did just the opposite. He didn't major in minors. He didn't nitpick. He just loved people and treated them how he wanted to be treated. And because of that, today, this community is buzzing around about someone who passed from this life way, way too early, as far as we're concerned. What can we learn from him? I believe if he was here today, he would say, "Get over yourself and just be nice to people. Just be nice. Don't expect so much from everyone else. Instead, give of yourself to make them better. Just be kind and treat people like you want to be treated." Point three. I have 74, but he loved that joke. No one would laugh, Paul. Paul was a new creation. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old is gone and the new life has begun. One day in June of 07, I was working in my office and Paul came to see me. It was some circumstances surrounding it that aren't really relevant. But that day we talked a long time. You see, I told you I was his loan officer many years before that. And by the way, he paid like clockwork. It probably doesn't shock you at all. He'd call me sometimes, "Hey, I can't get there today, I'll be in tomorrow." It's like one day late, and I'm like, "Paul, you should see my list of 50 day late. You know, you're good, just come." That day when Paul came in, he was tired of life the way it was. He wasn't happy. He wasn't happy with himself. He wasn't happy with his life. He was tired of life the way it was. We talked a long time about a lot of things, but then when it was all said and done, I was very candid with Paul, which he always told me was one of the things he liked about me. And I told him the truth. I said, "You're trying to live your life on your own. You've never given your life to God." "I know, God." I said, "You ain't given your life to him." "How do you know?" And I said, "Because I've asked you 3 questions that identify if that's happened, and you have not answered any of them right. You were trying to put God as an additive, like sweeten low to the tea, instead of letting him be the tea." He argued. I argued. I said, "Do this. Give us one try. Give this church one try. And if you don't like it, you don't have to ever come back and I'll never bother you again. But remember, Paul, you came to me. Now you're going to do what I said, or are you not?" "Well, he called me. "I'm coming tomorrow." "Okay." He came. Afterwards, I was going to my office. Someone stopped me. "It's Paul. Can I talk to you?" And I said, "Sure." And that day, I got to talk to Paul as he was ready to surrender all to Jesus. Completely give his life to Christ and follow the Lord in believer's baptism. And what an honor it was. Some of you were around when that happened. And what an honor it was to watch God begin to work on this dude. So I read it again. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old is gone and the new has begun. So instead of avoiding church at all costs, you couldn't keep the man away. Instead of being one who didn't give much thought to the way he lived, he began to seek godly counsel and go to the Word of God to tell him how to live. Instead of hoping no one said anything to him about God, he began to say things to people about God. He was a new man. He enjoyed locking up for more than one reason. It also gave him a place after everyone left to practice with his drone. He didn't think I knew. I knew. A couple of times I'd say, so how's your drone? I finally found out the reason he liked to practice in here is because he probably wouldn't lose it. He was afraid if he was outside, he might lose it. He doesn't need a drone to look over us anymore. Praise the Lord. Paul became a man who was greatly moved by watching God change other people. He came by one day to tell me about him leading a man to Christ in Walmart's parking lot. He was so excited. He told me all about what happened. He couldn't hardly get over it. He knew God was real. And he knew that God was not just for his eternity, but God was for his everyday. You might wonder how Paul got through the things that he faced. It's because he knew God. He had God not as an additive to change the taste of his life a little, but he was his life. Some of you are like, yeah, I didn't know that. Well, maybe you ought to give it a try too. Paul was sure glad he did, and I can tell you right now, the daughters both said to me, as we were basically waiting for the funeral home to come, thank you, Pastor. Today would be a very different day if it weren't for what God did to Paul, to Dad, at your church. You see, there's more than today, folks. There's more than today. I said it once and I'm going to say it again. Paul's outlook changed. His personality changed. His desires changed. The way he handled things changed after he gave his life to God. He wasn't perfect. Lord, no, he wasn't perfect. But neither am I. And neither are you. But Paul had experienced the grace of God, the unmerited favor of God. Something that none of us can ever see God if we don't experience. God's wonderful grace. He gave his life to Jesus Christ, and when he did, everything changed. So what can we learn from Paul? I believe, since Paul has gone to heaven, the Bible says to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. So I believe he's already seen Jesus face to face. I believe he's kind of done a little for him and maybe even faked hitting his head on the door, because he did that like I did. He was pretty good at it too. Paul was one of the last people that still laughed at me when I did that, you know, and he would go down. Sometimes we were the only two here. We just kept doing that for each other. So. But I believe if somehow Paul could leave the portal of heaven and come back here and stand in this pulpit. Prior to this, I don't know that he would have ever said a word except, tell him, Pastor. But I believe today he would say this. It's true. Do you know Jesus? Have you ever given your life to Jesus? Have you ever, A, admitted that you're a sinner? Have you ever, B, believed in the name of Jesus for salvation? Have you ever, C, committed your life to Him? Because it's real. And I believe He would plead with you to get rid of the sweet and low and make Jesus the tea. I ask you today, is Jesus just an additive to your life now and then, or is He one you go to just when things get tough or when you need something positive? Or has Jesus truly changed your life completely? I guess because I knew Paul before and after, he's one of the most drastic changes I ever was able to witness. And I don't think in any manner that Paul sat and talked to all of you the same way he did me about how much he loved God. I know that. But he did me. And I know how much he loved God. What an honor it would be today if someone in this room truly, completely, and wholeheartedly gave their life to Jesus Christ because of the life that Paul lived. I'm going to ask you, if you will, just to bow your heads, close your eyes. And I'm going to ask you a question, and I'm going to ask you to answer it silently in your heart. Do you know for sure, if you died right now, that you'd go to heaven? And by the way, that's not really a maybe question. When you know something for sure, you either do or you don't. Answer for yourself, yes or no, in your heart. Have you done what the scriptures say to do to receive the wonderful free gift of eternal life? If you can say yes, Pastor, I have, praise the Lord. But if you can't say yes, then I want to give you an opportunity right now to pray, to surrender your life to Jesus once and for all, and to experience the change that Paul experienced. Just silently repeat after me in your heart if your desire is to do that. Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. Help me to repent or turn away from them. I believe you are the Son of God. And I believe that you are the only way to heaven. And today I commit my life to you. I don't understand it all, but I do understand that I want you and I need you. And today I commit my life to you and ask you to become the Lord of my life. With every head bowed and every eye closed and no one looking around, if you prayed that prayer this afternoon and you meant it, I simply want to pray for you. I'm going to ask you right now, with every head bowed and every eye closed, just to look up until mine and your eyes meet. Then you can look right back down as an indication that you prayed that prayer. And I just want to pray for you. I see you. Thank you, sir. Others, thank you. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the wonderful power of your Holy Spirit, and for the gift of salvation that has been sought by several people in this room. Lord, the Bible tells us that the angels in heaven rejoice over just one soul that comes to you. And today we were experienced over a dozen. And I just can't imagine the angels rejoicing and knowing that my brother, my friend Paul, is part of that group that's rejoicing. Lord, I ask you to help these that have prayed to receive you to seek someone out who they know is a Christian. Help them, find them, and tell them today that they received you as their Lord, and get their advice on how to proceed. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness to Paul. We thank you for your faithfulness to us. In your precious and holy name we pray. Amen. We're going to see a video now. Turn your eyes to the screen.
for sure. Seems like the devil's always trying to get in my door. And just when I thought I couldn't take it anymore, here he came again, my friend. He keeps sending me angels from up on high. Should have been friends. Oh, here he comes again, my friend. He keeps sending me angels here to come fly. He keeps sending me angels to keep me from crying. He keeps sending me angels, sweet and true. He keeps sending. Among us, through the joy and the fear. When I look in your eyes, everything is so clear, my friend. Here it comes again. He keeps sending me angels from up on
gathered round your grave to grieve. Wish I could see angels' faces when they hear your sweet voice say, so go rest high. There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will darkness breaks.
and the grave is overwhelmed. Victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No
Well, Shelor definitely impacted this world and left it better than he found it. He loved people, he was kind, he was a new creation, and those three traits helped him leave us so much better than he found us. I challenge you to pick those traits up and live them out in his honor and in his memory. Paul and I shared a favorite scripture. And numerous times I would just get the reference to the scripture text to me from Paul. Sometimes walking through the lobby, he would just point at me and say it. And it was Psalms 30 and verse 5. Weeping endures for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Well, I want you to understand that no matter how much weeping Paul ever had on earth, his joy is now forevermore. No more night. No more pain, no more tears. Just peace forevermore. Pray with me. Father, we thank you again for loving us. We thank you for loving Paul, and we thank you for allowing your wonderful Holy Spirit to invade his life and make him the person that he was, Father. We just ask you now as we part from here, God, to allow the things that Paul did that made us chuckle, that made us feel good, that inspired us. Lord, allow those to fill our memory and our hearts, our minds. Let us hold on to those things. And when we think of him, let us think of the good times. And let everyone leave here knowing that they can see him again if they know you and trust you as their Lord and Savior. Be with this family as they walk from here and over the next few days and weeks and months ahead, Father, just help them to cling to you and each other. and remind them that you truly are as close as the mention of your name. In your name I pray. Amen.